So we'll discuss some inyani Shavuot. So there's a mitzvah on Yantiv, not just limited to Shavuot, but we'll see how Shavuot is different. There's a mitzvah on the Shalosh Regalim of Simchas Yantiv. And as well, perhaps there's a discussion, Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur is an element of Simcha as well. We'll save that for Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. But there's a basic mitzvah of Simcha, the Gemara in Psachim, and Ari Psachim talks about Simcha with Basar and Yayin, Bizman Beis HaMikdash Kayim, and we didn't have, so what about Bizman HaZeh? We don't have a Beis HaMikdash, we don't have the Karbanos. Does Simcha retain its biblical status? So that's a major machlokas harishonim, whether Simcha Bizman HaZeh is a mitzvah min HaTorah or a mitzvah midrabanan. It's actually a double machlokas, Rambam and the Bali Tosfos. It's based on the Gemara Moed Katan, Dav Yudalad Amid Beis. The Gemara tells us that there is no Avelis on Yantif. Now, how come we don't have Avelis on Yantif? So the Gemara tells us because the mitzvah, the Rabbim of Simcha, the public mitzvah of Simcha, overrides the private mitzvah of Avelis, because Simcha is for the Klal Yisrael, Avelis is a private affair, and hence the public mitzvah of Simcha beats out the private. That's the Gemara. So how do you learn this Gemara? So the Rambam learns the Gemara in both ways. So there's one issue is, what is the mitzvah of Simcha the right to draw banan, and what about the mitzvah of Avelis? So the Rambam sheet is, the mitzvah of Simcha, even Bizman HaZeh, is a mitzvah min HaTorah. It's apparently not linked only exclusively to the Karbanos. And even though we don't have Karbanos today, we still have the element of Simcha, as Rav Soloveitchik explained, being with Nei Hashem Elokech, that's enough, that's the element of Simcha. And whatever the Pshat in the Rambam is clear, the mitzvah of Simcha is Daraisa today. And who I did by Avelis, the Rambam Shita is another Sephardi Rishonim. Avelis Yom Rishon is Daraisa. The Shita of the Rambam is that Avelis on the first day is biblical. There's a further discussion whether you need Yom Misa and Kfura or just Kfura itself, but whatever the Shita is, Avelis Yom Rishon is Daraisa. So therefore the Rambam learns the Gemara as follows. The public biblical mitzvah of Simcha beats out the private biblical mitzvah of Avelis, and that's how you learn the Gemara. The Bali Tosfos learn the other extreme, that they hold the mitzvah of Simcha derais only bizman beis hamikdash kayim. You need the karbanos, the basar shlamim. Bizman hazeh is a mitzvah of Simcha, but it's only derabanan today. And as well, the shita of the Bali Tosfos and the shita's harama and the minhag Ashkenaz is, even Avelis Yom Rishon is Darabanan. All Avelis is Darabanan. There's a concept of Aninas, other things that perhaps are Daraisa, but Avelis, the Hugei Avelis are only Darabanan. So that's so how does Tosfos learn the Gemara? The public rabbinical mitzvah of Simchas Yantav beats out the private rabbinical mitzvah of Avelis. So according to the Rambam and Tosfos, they both learned the Gemara differently, but they're both consistent with the view. Interesting is, what about the following Shaila? So it's clear if you have a public biblical mitzvah, beats out a private biblical, and it's simple that if you have a public rabbinical, it beats out a private rabbinical. What about a public rabbinical versus a private biblical? So that's an interesting discussion. The Gemara in Bracha is Daf Mem Zayin. The Gemara talks about Rabbi Eliezer freeing a slave. So he walked into town, and there were only nine, and he had his Eved Kenani, and he went ahead and he freed his slaves. So the Gemara says, freed his slave? Doesn't he know Olam Ham Tavod is a prohibition? It's an Isser Aseh. So the Gemara says, no, he did it for a mitzvah. He did it for, we'll see what mitzvah in a minute. So the Gemara says, yeah, I know what mitzvah did. Doesn't he know the principle? As the Gemara tells us in Lulav HaGazel, mitzvah habab aveira. So what is a mitzvah? You can't do a mitzvah to the means in aveira. So the Gemara answers, mitzvah derabim shani. A public mitzvah is different. So either way, so the Gemara says, the public mitzvah of whatever we'll call a minyan, whatever it was, beats out the private biblical prohibition of freeing a slave. So what's the simple reading of that Gemara? That we see this seems to be a case where you have a public rabbinical mitzvah, tefillah b'tzibur, versus a private biblical, and we see from here that a public rabbinical mitzvah wins. We could see those want to argue with it and say, no, maybe we're talking about a public biblical mitzvah. What public biblical mitzvah could we be talking about? So actually, it's a famous rush by Parsha Zohar, which he says not to say, but others might say, if he's saying not to, that means someone else is saying to say it. In other words, there's different sheets on how do you fulfill your mitzvah of Parsha Zohar. So the Rambam, everyone agrees you need Zohar b'peh. Everyone agrees you have to verbalize it, and that's the Rambam Shita. Tosa says you have to verbalize it with the Sefer Torah. You have to read it from the Sefer Torah. And the Rush says you have to read it with the Sefer Torah with a minyan. Where does he get it from? Because the Gemara says, so the Rush writes over there, and don't tell me, you know why Rabbi Eliezer was able to free his slave? Because it was for Parsha Zohar. And therefore he wanted to fulfill the biblical mitzvah. So the question is, so what is freeing the Kasha, what's the Rush talking about? What does freeing a slave have to do? But then we see from the Rush is a Shita is, that you need to fulfill the mitzvah Parsha Zohar with a minyan. He just disagrees and he says that's not what Rabbi Eliezer, it wasn't Shabbos Parsha Zohar there. So others say, so if you hold it is Parsha Zohar, if you hold that Zohar it was, then you wouldn't bring a riot, so you can't bring me a proof. Tosis over there raises a more pragmatic question which comes up a lot, or it's not uncommon. The last day of Yontif, so in Chutz Laaretz, you have Yontif Sheni Shogolias. That's a mitzvah midrabanan, but it's a mitzvah derabim. So let's say you have Aveilah, so whatever the case is, let's say someone died on Cholomayit, so you already did the Kura, and now you're going to do the Aveilah, we'll begin right after Yontif. So when do you begin Aveilah? So that depends on the Shaila. If you hold a public rabbinical mitzvah of Yontif Sheni wins, again, according to the Rama, it's not a Shaila. According to Bnei Ashkenaz, there is no question because it's Drabbanan. Everything's Drabbanan, so you wait until after Yontif Sheni. But if you hold that Avelos Yom Rishon is the Raisa, so we have a case where a mitzvah diyakad verse, so that's a machokus in the Rishonim. Halach l'maisa, what do we do? What's the minig? Since we have a cloud by Avelos, Halacha l'divrei hamekel ba'aveilus. So therefore, what we do is we count Yontif Sheni as day one, but we don't start actually doing the hugei aveilus until the first day after. So that would depend on that child. That's the machlokas we showed him today between the Rambam and the Bali Tosis, whether the mitzvah of Simchas Yontif today is a mitzvah in our Torah or a mitzvah midrabanan. Okay. So the Gemara Emsachim Daf Samach Vav Samach Zayin or Samach Ches, one of the two, and Samach Ches Amabez points out that that was the official time.
I messed up totally.
Sorry,
totally for drink.
So
I really interrupted already. Is that really halacha?
I believe so, yeah. In fact,
people do that? That's counted as day one?
Yeah, because we're talking about someone, let's say...
Never heard that.
If someone dies over Yontif, you bury them on Cholomayit, so then when do you begin Avelis? So, I thought the minig was you count Yontif Sheni as day one, but you don't really start the Hugi Avelis on day two, because Allah is the Vermeiko. Are you familiar with that minig or not? Let's say someone dies on Yontif.
Yeah.
And so when does Avelis begin? You know, Yontif, it's a Shiloh that begins
second day, the second day of Yontif.
Yeah.
They count the second day of Yontif as the first day of Avelis.
Yeah, even though we don't know Avelis.
Right.
Yeah, no.
In fact, I had the
Shiloh, it must have been Pesach or Sukkot, because. It wasn't Pesach. Must have been Sukkot then, because they had it. Someone died. It was over. They died over Yontif, and so we had to do. I remember because they were actually because they were going to do the burial in Winnipeg, and I was telling him that they was, you know, I guess the conservative rabbi was telling him something else out there. I was more mako. I was telling him the shiva is over a day earlier. but because he was counting, you know, he was just counting from out there. Because since the machok has been shown him, so Allah there are mako, so we take both kulas.
Actually, it's a mission again, the chagiga, that
since
it
counts. Yeah.
The idea, the younger, it counts, but it doesn't.
Right, count. And we, so,
right.
Yom Tov Sheni.
Only 7 days.
Yeah,
so in Israel, it's not counting.
No, it shouldn't, because when Yom Tov is over, it's over. Unless, of course, you're keeping Yom Tov Sheni in Israel, then you'll have the same Shaila. That gets into, it depends which part of Lazar's family we're talking about. Everyone has a different sheet to there. Elie Sheva was telling me. They had, I think she was with you Pesach 1 year? Or one,
yeah, we had them all. We had all the different 2 days, 1.5 days, and 1 day, all going on simultaneously.
So that's the Machokas by Simchas Yom Tov, the Raisa Drabban. And so the Machokas and the Gemara Himsachim, how do you observe? So when you say Simchas Yom Tov is the Raisa Drabban, but how do you observe it? So that's the Machokas, Rabbi Elazar, Rabbi Yeshua. So Rabbi Elazar says it's either kul Hashem or kul Lachem. Either you could learn and daven all day, or you could party all day. Or Rabbi Yeshua says chatzi Hashem. What is it based on? V'shneim, they both darshan different sukkim. One pasuk says atzeres Hashem olkechem. Another pasuk says atzeres Lachem. So one says it's Hashem, one says it's Lachem. So how do you reconcile? So Rabbi Elazar says, when you have two psukim, the Israel of Yosef Engel points out, we have a general principle, when you have two psukim, who are machir zeh, what do we wait for? Bahashrishi, or machriya b'neim. But so the question is, what happens when you don't have a third pasuk? That's the Gemara here. What do you do when you don't have a third pasuk? This is the machokas, Rabbi Elazar, Rabbi Yeshua. So Rabbi says, either or, you can pick, either Hashem or Lachem. Of course, even according to Rabbi Elazar, you have to have your minimum Kiddush and a Suda, but we all know the difference between a weeknight meal and a Yantiv meal. A weeknight meal takes a couple of minutes. A Yantiv meal could take a couple of hours, but you're still going to need the minimum. But so they darshan it from the Pesukim. So Yeshua says, Chatzi Lashem v'chatzi Lachem. And in fact, it's Rabbi Elazar L'shitasan. The Gemara in Beya talks about, I think he was giving his shiur on Yantiv, and he was getting upset because he was going on and on and on, and you know, like it works. People in the back started sneaking out one by one, and he was getting upset at the people leaving because he was upset because L'shitasan, he felt they don't have to, where they sneak out to go to the Suda's Yantiv. He says you should be, you know, he passing for them, it's Hashem, and either way. So we passing our Rabbi Yeshua, it's Chati Hashem, Chati Lachem. In fact, the Rambam even gives us the order, and we assume even on Shabbos like this, Chati Hashem. That's why he goes to the order. First you daven Friday night, then you go and have the Suda, etc. That's why you have the davening, first Chati Hashem, and Chati Lachem. That's why the Vilna Gaon didn't like the practice that, let's say, quote-unquote early Shabbos like we have now. I don't know, but whether you like the early Shabbos, not a separate discussion, but I mean, it's a different minhagim, not that many, but normal early Shabbos is you daven and you go home and eat. But there used to be an old minhag, I don't know if people, it makes sense more if you're in a yeshiva, and when no one's not going anywhere. Basically, you daven mincha, you would go then, you know, maybe Kabbalah Shabbos, you'd go and have your suda. And then, you know, 2-3 hours later, you go back and die of Meir of Bismanum, you know, Shema. So the Vilna Gaon, you know, he was against that because he felt you need Chatzi Lashem first, you know, and Chatzi Lachem. But, you know, there's some Achronim bring down that minute. That's not the prevalent minute today. Anyway, I don't think because of the growth of Taina, people don't want to come back again. That's one of the reasons they want to go, is they want to go for the Prag HaMincha and then not come back after. So that's how we pass in Chatzi Hashem and Chatzi Lachem. That's the Machokas regarding Pesach and Sukkot. So that's the Machokas Rabbi Elazar Yeshua. Comes along the Gemara, however, regarding Atzeres, Hakol Modim, Modim Deba'inim Lachemet. Even Rabbi Elazar, who gives you the option of not having a major festive meal on, who gives you the option of not having one on Pesach and Sukkot, on Shavuos, he's moda to Rabbi Yeshua, you have to have a festive meal. My taima, what's the reason? The Gemara says, Yom Shenitna Bo Torah. It was the day the Torah was given. Then the Gemara goes on to give two other days where you also, Shabbos in Nidu Achem, Becharasako Shabbos Oneg, and also the Gemara says Purim as well, that by Yemei Mishta V'Simcha Ksiv, and those are the three places the Gemara says that everyone's mode, every Shabbos, you have to have a festive meal. Purim, and that's why Postim say, regarding the Shiloh of Simchas Yantav and meat, it could be Purim of all days might have the biggest chiyuv to have you. It's easy to get of eating meat on like Yantav, but meat is, if you only have to have meat one day of the year, some would say it should be Purim is more of an Indian, but you know, different minhagim, whether you do on, besides Shavuot's issue of having dairy or not, that's a separate question, whether dairy's in addition to meat or instead of meat, but that, you know, we'll see if we have time to get into that. But either way, they point out, so it's Yom Shenitna Bo Torah, so the question is obvious. It should be the opposite. I think the Gemara got a kol modim, Rabbi Yeshua should be modim to Rabbi Eliezer, that on Shavuot night, it's Yom Shenitna Bo Torah, that's the day you should be learning all night. And that's the custom, we learn all night. So what's going on here? So what's the pshat in the Gemara in Rabbi Eliezer? So the Mefarshim explain is that we see from this Gemara, and that's the Ramban in Parshas Mishpatim. It says, the Torah says, Vayochu Vayishtu. At Har Sinai, they ate and they drank, they were having a big party. Some in Chazal criticized, but others say, no, it was a good thing. They were, and from here, the Ramban says it was a good thing. Mikan, we learn out from Har Sinai that anytime you have any type of simcha by Torah, you make a suda. You have to make a suda soldat. So they're making a suda. Anytime there's any accomplishment by Torah, we make a suda. And that's what Rabbi Lezer is saying here. Even Rabbi Lezer agrees when it comes to Torah, we have to make a suda. In fact, that's so we can explain as well. What's the connection to Purim? So why on Purim, why do we have to have a meal? Because usually Purim and Chanukah are usually comparable. They're both post-biblical, and there are many similarities between Chanukah and Purim. So what are the differences? It's always interesting to see the difference when something's, if things are so far apart, like, so what's the difference? But when things are similar, it's always interesting to see the differences. So one of the major differences is, not according to the Rambam, but according to everyone else, that there's a Chiyuv Suda to eat on Purim, but on Chanukah there is no Chiyuv Suda. So everyone discusses why on Purim is there a Chiyuv Suda, but not on Chanukah. So there's a famous answer of the Lavush, because Chanukah, it was a spiritual thing. They wanted us to assimilate and accept the Torah. It wasn't a fit. So we celebrate through Hallel, Hodah, near Chanukah. But Purim, the Hashvan, the Havar, Koyudim, we celebrate in a physical way. That's the famous answer of the Lavush. But it's not as famous answer in the Shiltis, that they say no, because what happened on Purim? That's the famous Gemara in Shabbos, the Peches, where by Yitzyatzvu betachtis ahar, the Gemara says Kofen alav har kagigas. The God tilted over the mountain and said, "If you accept the Torah, good. If not, here will be your furaskam." So the Gemara says, "What are you talking about? It's great. It was forced upon us. Mikan mo the rabba daraisa. If that's the case, the Torah is not binding." The Gemara says, sorry, it's not going to help you. We could go back and discuss. The Gemara says, you're right, on Purim time, Kimu v'kibu, Kimu v'kibu k'fah, they accepted the Torah b'simcha. So from Purim time and on, it was binding. I, the Rishonim, asked, so what about then between the time of from Matan Torah until Purim? And in fact, we see that because the laws of Shemitah, we say they didn't keep them, they were punished. So different discussions, how do you explain the time period before Purim. But either way, for us, it doesn't make a difference. We're post-Purim. So therefore, we accepted the Torah B'Ava. So therefore, so that's why we have a Mesudah on Purim. Purim is a day of Kabbalah HaTorah. It's a day like Shavuot. In fact, we have four. We know there are Abba Rosh Hashanah. So Rosh Hashanah always likes to say there are four days of Kabbalah HaTorah. We have the day of the Luchos Rishonas, Shavuot. We have Yom Kippur, the Luchos Shniyas. According to the Kedushas Levi Purim, we have the Torah Shabbat Peh. And we just had recently, Rav Shimon Bar Yochai, Lag BaOmer, we had the Torah Sanister. So either way, so I guess that's why in Lag BaOmer, that's the reason to have a Chiyav Suda as well then, apparently. That's why they go to Meiron and they have a festive meal. It's a time of Kabbalah Satorah. That's why also, that's the famous Nitziv by the Karban Toda. He says, how come the Karban Toda, it's much bigger, it's much more food than its peers in terms of what you have to bring, and you have to finish it in a less time. So he says, that's the Yisod. When you're doing a Karban Toda, obviously you can't eat it yourself. You got to bring friends in, and you have to publicize it. And that's what Torah is all about, that you have to, that's why that's the Ramban, by Birkas HaTorah, the Ramban writes that Birkas HaTorah is a mitzvah min HaTorah, it's a Birkas Shevach Valda, it's a bracha thanking HaKadosh Baruch Hu every day, that God gave us the Torah. So that's what they point out here, that by Shavuot, that's what Rabbi Lez is saying. That's the reason why you have to have a chiyav suda, because any type of accomplishment with Torah is mechayev you to have a suda hodah. And in fact, that's what they and so today point out al pi makshava, the same concept that obviously in Judaism, in contrast to other religions, in terms of what's considered holiness, what's kedusha. So in other religions, it's going to a monastery, not getting married, staying away from the physical pleasures. But Gufa, that's what the Torah is teaching us. It's Yom. So one would think Yom Shana Bel Torah. So you think you go like Rav Shimon Bar Yochai, you go hide in the cave, you'll just go away. How do I celebrate the Torah? By just going into the Beis HaMedrash, not leaving for 24, 48 hours. And I'm just sitting and learning the whole time. And I'm not against that, but you just have to come and take a break for eating and doing other things as well. But that's what the Torah is telling us. Gufa, that's the whole essence of the Torah, is Kedoshim Tiyu, is being this Makadosh Shecho, is taking the physical things and using them. In fact, that's why we learn out from Avram Avinu, the Gemara tells us in Shabbos as well, we learn off in the story in the beginning of Vayera that when Avram was recovering from the Brit Mila, so HaKadosh Baruch Hu was doing Bikar Cholem, and we learn out Gedola HaKnosis Archim Bikabolas Pnei Ashchina. So how Avram knew it, that's a separate Shaila. But because the Rav Alfie explains how did he know it, because God told him. Well, where do we see God telling him? He said, no, based on the Rambam tells us about the Moshe Rabbeinu was up in the Neviim, and only Moshe Rabbeinu was speaking panim al panim. All the other Neviim, when they got Nevuah, they were in a spaced out, sleeping, dreaming. So every time when Avram was speaking to God before, it was like pitch black, he was dazed. All of a sudden, in the middle of speaking to God, he sees these three people. He says, why am I seeing someone? It must be God's teaching me, God's telling me, I got to take care of business here. And the Gemara says, Gedola Hachnosis Archim, in other words, if you want to get closer to God, how do you do it? By just speaking to God. We know talk is cheap in our religion. You have to go ahead and do things. So God would say, so that's what the Gemara is telling us, by doing acts of imitation, doing acts of chesed, that's how you come closer. So that's how, so it's Yom Shana Bel Torah, it's not just enough of this, the dangers of getting caught up in the exclusive spiritual. We have to combine both the Kodesh and Chol, and that's why it's Yom Shina Bo Torah. So that's why that's good for why we have to have a Chiyav Suda. What's this Indian of having milk and meat or not? So the different minhagim, it's based on depending on what the source of having milk is. Based on the Ramah says it's based on the Shtei HaLechem, that we want to have two, because the Shtei HaLechem, you have the two bread, so according to the Ramah, what do? You start off with a dairy meal. So the Lach is, we all know, that you can, if you cut up with a milk knife, the bread, you're not supposed to use that bread for meat. But Moshe has a kula, the stuff that's cut up is not made lama. Let's say you only cut up a quarter of a challah, half a challah. But Moshe's makel, if you want to make French toast Sunday morning on it, or then you can, assuming French toast is milchus anyway. But the stuff that's cut up, but in general, so the Rama wants to give us an area where we have to use a different bread. So first have dairy, do your necessary things that to be mafsik, wash your hands, and then you go, so that's based on the Shtei Halechem. The Mishnah Brewer gives probably the famous one they tell, you know, kids and stuff, is that basically we just got the Torah. We didn't know anything about kosher. We know how long it is to learn about kosher, all the laws of Hilchas Shechita, Malicha, all that. So they didn't have time to start learning all of Hilchas Kashrus, so they started learning. I guess that was the meaning of people just thinking all dairy is good, that you don't need Hashkacha, right? But that's why, but dairy is a lot easier to be kosher, so therefore until they got their act together. I think the Magen Avraham quotes from the Shla, the Arizal, that really has to do with, we're counting, it's like a woman counts Shiva and the Kiyam, we're counting the Shiva Shvuas, we're counting the 7 weeks, the time of purity between Kabbalah Satov, between Yitzias Mitzrayim and Matan Torah, and therefore milk represents purity, so therefore there's a concept of having dairy meal. Others say, I think Yeshua Yaakov says, that the long lines that we were saying, that the whole purpose is, that in the base of Levi says something similar, when God was giving the Torah to, showing it to Avram, giving it to Moshe, the angels were saying, no, it's for us, they're going to sin. No, he says, could you keep milk and meat, all that? He basically showed the Torah is not for the angels, the Torah is for human beings. So you want to put a scenario where, kind of like the Ramah, you need halachic reasons to work it out. But Yeshua Yaakov said, Dam Nekar V'Nase Cholav, that it starts off as blood, and whatever that means, the Gemara, and it turns into milk. I'm not sure what it means, but that's what the principle is, that something starts off as Dam Tameh, and it turns into purity. That's what Shavuos is all about. As the Gemara tells us at the end of that Gemara, as Rabbi Yosef, on every Shavuos, on Atzeres, he used to take an iglet, like a piece of calf, like the Gemara said in Megillah. He took a nice piece of beef ribs. I don't know if it was beef ribs, Miami ribs, beef tenderloin, I don't know, but it was clearly meat. And he used to take it out, and it says, if Lekka Atzeres, if it wasn't for Atzeres, I'd be Ike Yosef Beshuk, I'd be like any Joe in the Shuk. In other words, basically because it's Talmud says it's the Yantav Shavuos, we got the Torah, that distinguishes us. We can take the Torah and everyday life in Makadosh, that's what he says. The dairy somehow, you take the Dam and it's Nekar Cholav, and therefore we have the Torah has the ability to Makadosh Shechol, to take someone's tummy, and those are, you know, different reasons. So based on some of those reasons, you should have milk and then meat. According to others, it's enough just to have milk, or you could just have milk, you know, you could have milk, you know, treats. So that was, again, different minhagim. Again, you know, what, you know, whether you should have that milk, you know, whether you should have milk at all during the meals, or there should be milk in addition. That gets into what yeshita is in terms of Simchas Yantav.